is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 6, Blood Rites, Chapters 19, 20, and soon, 21. In these chapters, surprise, RoShawn wasn't ready. Were you? Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming down like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, won't spare no lives. Nobody's putting up a fight. Yeah, before we started recording, what was it you said? There's about 3 pages. You said something about how short it was, this the first 2.
I said that they were really 3, that it was really exciting, and then the last like 3 lines.
Oh, right. That's it. Because this is why I couldn't decide which one to read. The chapter that you finished with, or the chapter that I'm going to read to you, and I decided to go with the one I'm going to read to you. But
so I get the big reveal.
So you just don't get anything.
But then it just stops.
Did I frustrate you? Did I make you annoyed?
A little bit.
Good.
Because the last word is, well, the last 2 words. Our mother. Guys.
It was so, I really enjoyed, because, like, you know, obviously there hasn't been much talk, but it was just what, the previous episode or the episode before, where you were like, I really want to know why Thomas is so invested and keeps on, there's something not right here. And I was just like, no, that's weird, huh?
Yeah. And, you know, I had had this kind of this bug up my ass for the last couple books, thinking that there was going to be a big reveal about Harry and his mother. But I thought it was going to be that Harry wasn't all human. And that could still be a thing. But I did not in a million years even consider that it would be anything like this.
Well, that's delightful.
Like, just like for all of my, you know, conspiracies about what might be going on with Harry's mom, and what, because I even said a book or two ago about how I feel like we just don't know enough about her, what her deal was. It never occurred to me that she could have other children and that one of them would be fucking not just a vampire, but Thomas. Come on.
Yeah.
So, all right, Mr. Butcher.
Okay. He got you.
He did. And this is, Jesus Christ, what book is
6?
This? 5 or 6?
6. 10 more to go.
So he strung me along for 6, like 5.5 books. Before he even gave me something this, like, crazy. And there's still 10 to go. Like, Harry's going to end up being from, like, Mars or something.
All right, so we kind of... Hi, everyone. I'm Natasha.
Oh, I'm RoShawn.
This isn't the only thing that happens, obviously, in these first 2 chapters. There's something else that goes on.
Yeah, it's pretty sad.
Yeah, it is.
But before we get to that, we meet the dad.
Yeah, so this dad knows Harry's fucking name.
This guy is scary as shit, y'all. I mean, so Lara had told us, and me and you talked about it a little bit, because we were talking about how Lara says that her father would kill Harry. Right. Or anybody, really, right? And there was some discussion about whether I took it like it would mean he would personally kill Turns out that he doesn't really get down like that anymore. He doesn't get his hands mm-hmm. dirty. But that he clearly has a past where he used to. And Thomas... But anyway. But that he's fucking scary as shit. He's so, like, he's cold as ice.
Willing to sacrifice. How could I not?
You really couldn't. I mean, I would have been so disappointed if you hadn't. But there's a minute where he, like, waves his hands and everybody just, like, pulls, like, you know, what do you call it? Where they cock the hammer on the gun, ready to, like, shoot everybody's head off.
Yeah, he doesn't even say.
He just waves his hand.
And it's, like, about to happen. Like, before they even realize what that meant, he's about to be dead. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah.
Yes. Doesn't Lara have to jump in front of him like, no?
Yes.
Like,
to which she's flat out, why?
Oh my God.
Like,
I like the way that, he has this, I don't know if it's an accent or a way of speaking, but like when, okay. So the dad shows up and they're all fucked up, you know, cause they just had the big fight with the black mm-hmm. court and, the dad is upset because Inari is hurt. And Lara's like, well, you know, Bruce can fix her up. And he goes, which is Bruce?
Yes. And Harry's like expecting her to be like irritated. And I'm like, dude, have you not seen what's happening here yet? Like, of course she's not irritated. He could literally like crook his finger.
Yeah. But... And he's very like... He says to Inari, what happened to you, daughter mine? He says to Lara, what does he call her?
I don't remember.
Dearest daughter or something?
That sounds like him. I believe you.
You know, it's just all these endearments.
Yeah, that are kind of antiquated.
Right. Yeah, very antiquated. And also, they feel, to me, slightly... Threatening is not the right word, but you know how you think someone talks that way and it's supposed to inspire warmth?
Mm-hmm.
It did not.
No, I can understand.
For me, anyway. Not even a little bit. Like, hearing him talk to them, to Nari and to Lara, and he's calling them all these sweet little names, but it doesn't for even a second feel like a genuine, healthy... fatherly affection.
No, it's more like the kind of thing that somebody starts to be like, sweetie, why is there another woman's name in your phone? Hun? Like, it's almost like when he starts talking that way, it's more dangerous than otherwise.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Like I said, the first word that popped in my head was threatening, but it didn't. Menacing maybe is
okay,
better.
Okay. Yeah. I like that.
But, so they're having this conversation back and forth, Lord Raith, Lara, talking about Inari. What happened, and then Harry is just like, all right, look.
Oh my God.
People.
He tells them to shut their mouths 3 times.
Yeah. He is so lucky he didn't get his head blown.
Oh my God. It's like, honestly, I know that he can be a smart ass pain in the ass all the time, in the best of times. Like, but mm-hmm. this is one of those moments where even I was kind of shocked.
Right.
I was just like, Harry. Guy,
only thing, it's got to be that bear. It's got to be the bear buckle still coursing through
the
brains. Because this is lunacy.
That actually would make a lot of sense.
Even for Harry, this is ill timed and ill considered to be talking to this man of such demonstrable power, right? This way, in Harry's condition. It's got to be. He's all hopped up on bear juice. That sounds terrible. Way worse than I meant.
Oh, God. Hopped up on bear juice. All right. So, moving right along.
Sorry. My apologies.
So, they finally do shut their mouths and help. And Harry and Lara carry in Thomas, who is practically dead almost.
How great is it? Because there's like plenty of bodyguards and they pick Inari up and, you know, carry her gently off to be, you know, ministered to. But they just leave Thomas there and Lara and Harry have to carry him. And Harry is like, even though there are plenty of people around who could be doing
this. I guess I'll do it, for Christ's sake, you monsters. Which they are.
They are. And I just thought it was funny that Lord Raith was like, yeah, y'all can mm-hmm. get that.
Yeah, by shut your mouths and help, did you mean not kill you? Is that? Because I'll do that, but only begrudgingly. And
Lara's like, no, don't shoot. You might hit Thomas. And he's like, no, I trust their marksmanship.
Yeah, you know, Thomas is probably fine. Whatever.
Oh, he does not like
he
Thomas.
Don't. So they bring Thomas inside, and this is when Lara is like, so he needs to eat. And Harry's like, what are you gonna do? She's like, I'll find him somebody. And he's like,
yeah,
you're gonna find him someone to kill. And she's like, or else he will die. So, yeah. And Harry's like kind of in the middle of this like argument with her about it. And then the bear juice just drops away. Yeah. And he's suddenly like, okay, all right. You know what? Do what you need to do because I am asleep now.
Yeah. The thing that happens is when they get to Thomas's room, which is where Lord Raith tells Lara to take them, mm-hmm. right? Take them specifically to Thomas's room. When he gets there and Lara's explaining to him that Thomas is going to die unless he feeds, and they're having this conversation, and Harry realizes that they're being followed and it's one of the bodyguards. Mm-hmm. And then Harry starts to put it together and he's like, that's what the bodyguard is there for. And he is, you know, really upset. And Lara leaves and Harry has this whole thing with, what's her name? Justine. Mm-hmm. Trying to kind of talk her out of it because she realizes immediately how bad Thomas is hurt yeah. and what's going to happen next. And she knows what this mm-hmm. is and she agrees to it. And she's like, I'm going to do it because I love him. If I don't do it, he'll die. And it's really sad. Mm-hmm. And, Harry is like, you know, you don't have to do this. And she's like, no, of course I have to do this. I love him. I'm not going to let him die. And she asked Harry to please tell Thomas, you know, that she loved him.
Right.
And then Harry's in the middle of arguing with Justine when the bear juice goes and she has to put him to bed.
Yeah, she tells Harry to tell Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
And he does.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
what did you think of her choice here?
You know what? I was really touched by this scene. We met Thomas and Justine, you know, a couple of books ago. And when we first meet them, it seems kind of gross, right? This relationship that they have. And it feels very much like, oh, he's the evil vampire and she's just enthralled and, you know, she's the victim here. Right. But I feel like over the last couple of books, every time we do see them, it starts to feel like it is much more of a two-way street. Mm-hmm. And like they both understand what this relationship is and that it is as real as it can be, considering what he is. You know what I mean? Like, he loves her as much as he is capable of loving someone, which maybe by our standards isn't enough, mm-hmm. you know? But for Justine, she has decided that it's enough for her because she really loves him. And Harry says, you know, but you're also addicted to him. And she's like, yeah, but it doesn't mean I don't love him.
Yeah.
You know. And it kind of hits that sort of sad, sort of tragic love story that we kind of, or that I can be very susceptible to, you know. So when she decides to do this, I don't know, it felt, I was really sad for them both. I was sad for her and I was sad for Thomas, because I knew that once he started to feed, that was a wrap, that she was gone. Yeah. You know, she says to Harry at one point, like, maybe he'll stop, but it doesn't even seem like she believes that when she says it. So I knew she was donezo, but I was just like, I was sad for them both, and it felt right for what I've known of these two characters of her from what we've read before. It really does seem like something, a decision she would have made.
Yeah, I agree with that. And it's the kind of thing, like, when you think about what you would do, I would have to. Right? Mm-hmm. Like, it's kind of a bummer because you know that they're going to carry that forever. So saving them is almost a curse, because if I was dying and we have Owen over here doing something to save me and I have to wake up and he's dead in mm-hmm. order to save me and I have to live with that forever, I'm not getting over that, ever.
Yeah, and that's the part that makes me so sad for Thomas, is that he is, I feel like, will probably... I don't know what guilt for vampires really looks like, but whatever that is what he's going to be carrying, mm-hmm. you know? I would imagine that he's probably fed and killed lots of people in however many years he's been doing mm-hmm. this. But I don't know. I really think that he had something special with her.
Yeah, I agree.
And it's fucked up that... Like, I don't know what that estate, the Raith estate, has got going on, but it's a family of vampires. I feel like the dad could have sent somebody in for Thomas. It didn't have to be Justine. Mm-hmm. Right? Is that crazy? That makes me sound like, oh, well, anybody, it would have been better if someone else had died. And that's kind of callous, guys, but you know what I mean. Like, don't they have, like, a dungeon of people that they use?
That's a good question.
I don't know. What the logistics are, but it just felt like making sure that Thomas is going to be in need of killing someone and making sure that he is in the room with the woman he loves seems really heartless and vindictive on his father's part.
Yeah, I can't disagree with you on that. So Harry passes out, wakes up, decides that it's time to get the fuck out, and the door is locked.
Because of course it is. Because
of course it is. And he's about to just try and blast it off the hinges when Thomas comes in with a bag of clothes for him.
Right. And it turns out he locked the door to keep him safe.
Yeah, he's like...
But I wasn't thinking
that. No! I mean, why would you, right? Like, yeah. And of course, at this point, like, this big statement that Thomas makes, it's not out. So you don't know still quite whether mm-hmm. to trust him still.
Yeah.
And this is when Harry's like, so how's Justine?
Oh, he's being really cruel here.
He really is. It's kind of too much.
It a little bit. And I was surprised because, I mean, Harry had a whole conversation with her. And I feel like he's being kind of unfair. And I know he's got this thing about women and damsels in distress and all that kind of stuff. But this, the way he's being felt like, again, particularly cruel, mm-hmm. which isn't something for all of Harry's flaws. Being a smart ass and, you know, not reading the room and not having any tact. But I don't ever think of him as being cruel.
Yeah, I would agree with that. So Thomas is like clearly kind of crumpling under this assault. And then Harry says, you know, the last thing she told me was to make sure that I told you she loves you.
Yeah.
And go ahead.
Yeah. I was going to say, he says, short of running a chainsaw into Thomas's guts, I don't think I could have hurt him anymore. Yeah. Like,
and he says this with, like, satisfaction, it feels like. You know, mm-hmm. like...
It does. Yeah. It does. And even after he says this thing... Because right after that, Harry is like, I need to, you know, I'm going to leave. Mm-hmm. He, like, starts to walk out. And Thomas is like, dog, you can't at least wait till the sun comes mm-hmm. up. You know, he's still trying to protect Harry. Even after he said this incredibly hurtful, pointed thing.
Yep.
So, at this point, again, I'm just like, what is Thomas's deal? I don't understand. Because I'd have been like, fuck you, Dresden. Go ahead out the front door. I don't give a fuck.
So, basically, he finally leaves. Like, Harry's like, fine, I'm going to go shower. And he leaves. And...
takes the longest hot shower.
Yeah, I love this detail because I always forget Harry doesn't have hot water, which is just some bullshit, like, frankly.
Yeah. I love how impressed he is, too.
Right.
Because he's like, I don't know what this guy's got going on with his water heater.
But that shit stayed hot. So he gets out and he's all going about his business of getting ready, and there's a lot of steam. And so he doesn't notice that the little baby vampire sisters come on in.
And she seems also hopped up on something. Mm-hmm. She's wearing this
window. Oh, is that the worst?
It's awful. Yeah. Why would he do that?
I'm pretty sure he wants this to be really uncomfortable.
Well, kudos, mm-hmm. sir. Job completed. Yep. Because this was really uncomfortable. And even though I know she's of age, because they tell us when we meet her that she's like 18 or mm-hmm. something, it was still just, it was too much.
Yep.
And she's got a puppy in one arm and like a little kid's pajama top. And she basically starts coming on to Harry. Mm-hmm. And he cannot resist. He's powerless.
It's really like, I think, because, I mean, let's be honest. She's 18 and wearing a Winnie the Pooh shirt is just weird. Am I wrong? At 18?
You know, I feel like, and this is based on nothing but the couple of lines, I feel like that is what is in her closet at her dad's house.
Okay.
Because she, either by choice or by rule... she is still occupying this juvenile station, this little kid station.
Gotcha.
So, yeah. But even with that theory, I still don't like it.
No, absolutely fucking not.
I don't care for it at all.
So, yeah, she comes in. As you say, he cannot resist. And... they start making out, and her eyes are, like, white. And she's saying that, you know, I've never felt this for anyone. And starts kissing him. And then, after a good long minute of kissing,
mm-hmm.
she pulls away, screaming.
Yeah.
Because her lips are burned.
Yeah. Yeah, there's blisters rising around her mouth, and she is in pain, and she's panicking, and she doesn't even seem to understand what she's even doing there. Never mind, like, why is her mouth all fucked up? And she's confused, and she's scared, and Thomas comes in, you know, and kind of calms her down, and she's, you know, freaking mm-hmm. out, because she... again, she does not understand what she's doing there. She doesn't understand why she felt that way. She doesn't understand what just happened when she kissed him. What is going on with her? And I think we had talked before about whether or not... because when the Black Court attacks them, she doesn't know what they are.
Right.
And she even tells her dad when he, at the beginning of the other chapter, that they got mugged.
Right.
Right. Because she just can't, like, it makes no sense. Mm-hmm. So, like, she's trying to rationalize it. And so it turns out that, at least in this family, I can't remember if Thomas says it's the white court period or if it's just his dad's rule. I think it's his dad's rule. That they don't know what they are until they get to a certain age.
Right.
Which is... why, though?
I think because it's a good way to control them.
Power? Mm-hmm. It's just about power. Jesus.
And man. I actually kind of wonder, now that I think about it, if her wearing that Winnie the Pooh shirt isn't meant to, like, not only make us uncomfortable, but also really get across how sheltered she is. That, like, for her age, she's being treated like a child. Like, mm-hmm. And that it's sort of like, you know, somebody who grew up really, really sheltered.
That's what I mean by, like, that's her station in a family. Like, she's still just, like, a little kid. And I don't, again, I can't. The fact that the dad keeps them in the dark about what they are definitely makes me think it is at the father's discretion that she's treated this way and sheltered and doesn't know what's going on. But also, the dad is upset with Lara because Lara let something happen to Inari. Mm-hmm. Like, she's supposed to be responsible for her little sister when they're out in the world.
Right.
What was I going to say? But she's also, like, out working on the set. Mm-hmm. You know, so she has some, I don't know if independence is the right word, but she's not so sheltered that she's not allowed out in the world.
Right.
And to work on a porn set. Right. You know? So whatever kind of sheltered she is, it's not, I think, what we would consider sheltered.
Right.
You know, when we talk about, oh, you don't let your kids watch bad movies, you know, or
yeah, it's movies, but definitely, you know what I mean? On a whole different level. Because, like, again, remember how she's talking to him on the phone? What an awful thing to say. I thought dads were supposed to chase the boys away with a shotgun.
Right,
like,
right.
It feels like he's encouraging her sexually. He's, like, making mm-hmm. jokes and having her work on a porn set and seemingly to, like, push things along, maybe?
Right. I remember when we talked about that scene on the phone, I suggested that it felt like he was doing the opposite of mm-hmm. of that, like, saying something maybe even kind of sexual or filthy. Mm-hmm. Which... okay, so she ends up in Harry's room, and do we talk about how she got there?
I believe Thomas tells Harry, yeah, because Harry...
Is it after the love thing?
Yes, I think so.
Okay.
Because he's like, right, it's before the love thing. Because they talk about that as they're walking. But when Harry's like, you know what, I'm going to leave, forget this. And Thomas is like, don't go that way, because if Father sees you leaving, he's going to try and kill you again.
That's right.
And Harry's like, wait, what? And he's like, yeah, she didn't come in here by accident. Like, that. This is a really believable way for him to deny any wrongdoing on his part or any violation of guest right, while still eliminating you. And nobody would be able to do shit about it because she's new to this, doesn't know what she is, and lost control, and that happens all the time.
Okay. All right, okay. Mm-hmm. Well, shit.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. So then they have the conversation about what it actually happened to her mouth.
Right. And, what it is that love is basically poisonous to the white court.
And since the last person that Harry has been with was Susan, who he loved and she loved him, that has offered a kind of protection
right.
to Harry, at least from the white court.
Right.
Now, Thomas says they couldn't hurt him, but I wonder... does that just mean that they're like their wiles don't work on him?
No, because when Harry says, well, then why am I still adjusting my pants every time Lara walks by? Thomas is like, well, you're human and she's lovely and you also haven't gotten any in a really long time.
Mm.
So it still works. It's just when they actually go to touch him, which is how they feed, they get burned, so they can't do it. They can't feed on him.
Okay, so they just can't feed on him. All right, gotcha. So yeah, this idea that love is the enduring protector is sweet. You know, when they brought up Susan, I thought it was going to be because she was a vampire.
Hmm, that's interesting.
And that was the connection, you know, that like she had somehow already marked him and because she's of a different court.
Right.
But it turned out to be that it was just love. True love.
You get out of here. Yeah, this is something that I kind of go back and forth on how I feel about it. And I know Owen hates it.
It's a little hokey. Yeah.
And it's like, it kind of makes sense. And the whole idea that, like, you know, we imitate what we need in order to get people to have sex with us. But sex is about not only the merging of people, but it is how you create a whole new human being and a new soul.
Yeah, I liked that soul.
Yeah,
part.
I thought that was a really interesting way to approach it.
I like that much more than just the idea that love is somehow protects you from, because it's, what does Thomas say about, he says something like, Lara still has a scar from picking up a wedding mm-hmm. ring, and he named someone else who I don't, his cousin,
Madeline.
who picked up a rose and got sick from the thorns, and that, I don't know. I guess, like, lust versus love. Love will always win. Mm-hmm. But I feel like that shit ain't true. Mm-hmm. You know? It's really not.
Yeah.
So just love on its face doesn't beat out lust. But then when he starts to talk about how it's how you create a new soul, that part, I was like, oh, okay, I can dig it. That part, all right, you're on to something.
Oh, we are such cynics. What? No. That's not how that goes. Shut up. Yeah. No, I feel you on that.
And then Thomas quotes the fucking chapter from the Bible that everybody reads at their wedding. Doesn't everybody read that at their wedding now?
It really, you know, listen, bunch of people across America are feeling called the fuck out right now.
Sorry, guys.
Sorry, everybody, but... Yeah,
it's
basic.
Either this or the fucking Shakespeare sonnet.
Oh God,
those are the two staples.
Yeah, that's the under Webster's dictionary defines love as. yeah, this is another moment. Like, because I was talking to Owen about this chapter and that this was coming up, and he was just like, "Oh God, how love saved him!" And then he reads the Bible. He can't stand this part. And I was just kind of cracking up, like, because I felt like that a little bit, but it really didn't bother me as much as it clearly bothers him.
I like what Thomas says after the chapter, though. He says that their father makes them memorize that because it's like the little cross bones that are on point, that's on poison.
Right.
And I was like, oh, okay. Okay.
Yep. It's, and like you had said before, Lara's got the scar still from the wedding mm-hmm. ring. And Madeline got pricked by the thorn on a rose that was given from one lover to another and was in bed for a full week. So mm-hmm. this is no joke. So, all right. Then he drops that bomb. Are you ready?
Oh, we're just going right to okay.
You ready?
Okay, I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm just gonna portrait hall. Okay,
we're just there. You know, whatever they see their mom, whatever. It's fine. And it ends with he slipped a few fingers under the turtleneck and drew out a silver chain. He passed it to me, and I saw that the chain held a silver pentacle much like my own. In fact, precisely like my own. Not yours, Harry, Thomas said, his voice quiet and serious. I stared at him. Our mother, he said. I stared at him hard, my heart lurching with shock, and my view narrowed down to a gray tunnel centered on Thomas. Silence filled the room. You're lying, I said. I'm not. You must be. Why? He asked. Because that's what you do, Thomas. You lie. You use people, and you lie. I'm not lying this time. Yeah, you are, and I don't have time to put up with this crap. I started for the door. Thomas got in my way. You can't ignore this, Harry. Move. But we... My vision went red with rage, and I hit him in the face for the second time in 6 hours. He fell to the floor, twisted his hips, and swept my legs out from under me. I hit the ground, and Thomas piled onto me, going for an arm lock. I got a leg underneath me and sank my teeth into his arm as he tried to get it around my neck. I pushed up and slammed him against a wall with my body, and we both staggered apart. Thomas got to his feet, scowling at his arm where I bit him. I leaned against the wall, panting. It's the truth, he said. He wasn't as winded as I was from the brief scuffle. I swear it. A half-hysterical chuckle slipped out of my mouth. Wait, I've seen this one before. This is where you say, search your feelings, you know it to be true. Thomas shrugged. You wanted to know why I'd been helping you, why I risked myself for you. Now you know why. I don't believe you. Huh, Thomas said. I told you that too. I shook my head. You said it yourself. You use people. I think you're playing me against your father somehow. It might work out that way, he said, but that's not why I asked you to help Arturo. Why then? Because he's a decent man who doesn't deserve to get killed, and there's no way I could have done it on my own. I thought that over for a moment, then said, but that's not all of it. What do you mean? Inari. You went nuts when that vamp was on her. Where does she fit in? Thomas leaned up against the wall beside my mother's portrait. He pushed his hair back from his face with one hand. She hasn't been taken by her hunger yet, he said. Once she starts feeding it, there's no going back. She'll be like the rest of us. My father is pushing her toward that point. I want to stop him. Why? Because if she's in love... That first time, it could kill her hunger. She'd be free. I think she's mature enough to be capable of that love now. There's a young man she's all Twitter-pated about. Bobby? I blurted. The macho violent kid? Give him a break. How insecure would you be if you were planning on spending the day having sex on camera in front of the girl you'd like to ask to dinner? This might shock you, but I've never really considered that question before. Thomas pressed his lips together for a moment and then said, if the kid loves her in return, then she could have a life. She could be free of the kinds of things that... His voice broke, and he had to cough before he continued. Things like what happened to Justine. Like what my father has done to my other sisters. What do you mean, done to them? He establishes that he is their superior. He overpowers them, pits his hunger against theirs. My stomach twisted. You mean he feeds on his own? I couldn't finish the sentence. Do you need me to paint you a picture? It's the traditional way to settle family differences in all the houses of the White Court. I shuddered and looked up at my mother's portrait. God, that's hideous. Thomas nodded, his expression bleak and hard. Lara is one of the most capable, intelligent people I've ever met, but around him, she turns into an obedient dog. He's broken her to his will, forced her to crave what he does to her. I won't let that happen to Inari, not when she could make her own life. I frowned. Won't that bring your dad down on you? Force him to try to make you like them? Thomas grimaced. His tastes don't run that way. Small mercy, I guess. Not really. He doesn't want to keep me around. It's just a matter of time before he comes after me. His sons, every last one of them, died under suspicious circumstances that can't be traced back to him. I'm the first male to live as long as I have, partly thanks to you. He closed his eyes. And partly thanks to Justine. Hell's bells, I said quietly. The whole thing was almost ridiculous. So let me get this straight. You want me to help save the girl, overthrow the Dark Lord, and defend the innocents terrorized by dark magic, I said. And you want me to do it because you're my long-lost half-brother who needs someone noble to stand beside him in desperate battle for what's right. He grimaced. That phrasing has way more melodrama in it than I would have used. You've got to be kidding me. That's a really lame con. Give me some credit, Dresden, he sighed. I know how to con. If you were really just another mark, I'd have come up with a better story. Forget it, I said. If you'd been straight with me to begin with, maybe I'd help, but this bullshit about my mother is over the line. She's my mother, too, he said. Harry, you knew she wasn't exactly white as the driven snow. I know you've learned a little over the years. She was one hell of a dangerous witch, and she kept some bad company. Some of it was with my father. You're lying, I growled. What proof have you got? Would anything satisfy you? He demanded. Proof is something you use with rational people, and right now you aren't. The anger started fading a little. I hadn't gotten much rest and was too tired to keep it up. I ached. I slid down the wall until I was sitting. I rubbed at my eyes. It doesn't make any sense. What would she have been doing hanging around with her father? God knows, Thomas said. All I know is that there was some sort of business between them. It developed into something else. Father was trying to snare her permanently, but she wound up being too strong for him to completely enthrall. She escaped him when I was about 5. From what I've been able to learn, she met your father the next year when she was on the run. Running from who? He shrugged. Maybe my father. Maybe some people in the courts or on the council, I don't know. She'd gotten into some bad business and she wanted out. Whoever she was in it with didn't want her gone, they wanted her dead. He spread his hands, palms up. That's almost everything I know, Harry. I tried to learn all I could about her, but no one would talk to me. My eyelids felt gummy. My chest hurt. I looked up at the portrait of my mother. She was a woman of evident vitality, life flowing from her and around her, even in the painting. But I'd never gotten the chance to know her. She died in the delivery room. Damn it all, what if Thomas was playing it straight with me? It would mean that I knew a little more about why the White Council all watched me like I was Lucifer, the next generation. It would mean being forced to accept that my mother was involved in bad business. Scary, big, bad business of one kind or another. And it would mean that I maybe wasn't entirely alone in this world. There might be family for me. Blood of my blood. The thought made my chest hurt worse. As a child, I'd fantasized for hours at a time about having a family. Brothers and sisters, parents who cared, grandparents, cousins, aunts and uncles, just like everyone else. A group of people who would stick together through everything, because that's what families do. Someone who would accept me, welcome me, maybe even be proud of me and desire my company. I never celebrated Christmas as a kid after my dad died. It hurt too much. Hell, it still hurt too much. But if I had a real family, then maybe things could change. I looked up. Thomas's face had always been difficult to read, but I saw another mirror of myself there. He was having some of the same thoughts as me. I wondered if he'd been lonely like I had. Maybe he'd daydreamed about a family who wouldn't be trying to manipulate him, control him, or simply kill him. But I stopped myself before I could follow that line of thought. Things were just too dangerous and this issue too sensitive. I wanted on some level to believe Thomas. I wanted to believe him very much, which was why I couldn't afford to take any chances. After a long moment, he said, I'm not lying to you. My voice came out soft, quiet, and calm. Then prove it. How? He asked. He sounded tired. How the hell am I supposed to prove it to you? Look at me. He froze, his eyes still on the floor. I don't think that would accomplish anything, Harry. Okay, I said. I started to rise. Which way is my car? He lifted a hand. Wait. All right, he said. He grimaced. I was hoping to avoid this. I don't know what you're going to see if you look in there. I don't know if you'll still feel the same way about me. Ditto, I said. We better sit down. How long will it take? He asked. Seconds, I said. Feels longer. He nodded. We sat down about 2 feet from each other, cross-legged on the floor at the foot of my mother's portrait. Thomas took a deep breath and then lifted his gray eyes to mine. The eyes are a window to the soul, literally. Looking someone steadily in the eyes is an uncomfortable, intense experience for anyone. If you don't believe me, pick a stranger sometime and just go up to them and stare them in the eye until that moment where there's a sudden acknowledgement of lowered barriers, that moment that inspires awkward silences and racing hearts. The eyes reveal a lot about a person. They express emotions and give clues to what thoughts are lurking behind them. One of the first things we all learn to recognize as infants are the eyes of whoever is taking care of us. We know from the cradle how important they are. For wizards like me, that kind of eye contact is even more intense and even more dangerous. Looking into someone's eyes shows me what they are. I see it in a light of elemental truth so clear and bright that it burns into my head forever. I see the core of who and what they are doing during a soul gaze, and they see me in the same way. There's nothing hidden, no possibility of deception. I don't see absolutely every thought or memory that passes through their head, but I do get to see the naked, emotional heart of who and what they are. It isn't a precise research technique, but it would tell me if Thomas was playing it straight. I met Thomas's gray eyes with my own dark gaze, and the barriers between us fell. I found myself standing in a stark chamber that looked like an abstract of Mount Olympus after its gods died. Everything was made of cold, beautiful marble, alternating between utter darkness and snowy light. The floor was laid out like a chessboard. Statuary stood here and there, all human figures carved in stone that matched the decor. Particolored marble pillars rose up into dimness overhead. There wasn't a ceiling. There weren't any walls. The light was silver and cold. Wind sighed mournfully through the columns. Thunder rumbled somewhere far away, and my nose filled with the sharp scent of ozone. At the center of the forlorn ruin stood a mirror the size of a garage door. It was set in a silver frame that seemed to grow from the floor. A young man stood in front of it, one hand reaching out. I walked a little closer. My steps echoed among the pillars. I drew closer to the young man and peered at him. It was Thomas. Not Thomas as I had seen him with my own eyes, but Thomas nonetheless. This version of him was not deadly beautiful. His face seemed a little more plain. He looked like he might have been a little nearsighted. His expression was strained with pain, and his shoulders and back were thick with tension. I looked past the young man into the mirror. There I saw one of those things that I would want to forget, but thanks to the sight, I wouldn't. Ever. The reflection room in the mirror looked like the one I stood in at first glance, but looking closer revealed that rather than black and white marble, the place was made from dark, dried blood and sun-bleached bone. A creature stood there at the mirror directly in front of Thomas. It was humanoid, more or less Thomas's size, and its hide shone with a luminous silver glow. It crouched, hunched and grotesque, though at the same time there was an eerie beauty about the thing. Its shining white eyes burned with silent flame. Its bestial face stared eagerly at Thomas, burning with what seemed to be unsatiated appetite. The creature's arm also extended to the mirror, and then with a shiver I realized that its limb was reaching a good foot past the mirror's surface. Its gleaming claws were sunk into Thomas's shaking forearm, and drops of dark blood had run from the punctures. Thomas's arm, meanwhile, had sunk into the mirror, and I saw his fingers digging in hard upon the flesh of the creature's forearm. Locked together, I sensed that the two were straining against each other. Thomas was trying to pull himself away from the thing. The creature was trying to drag him into the mirror, there among the dried blood and dead bones. "He's tired," said a woman's voice. My mother appeared in the mirror, wearing a flowing dress of rich royal blue. She watched the silent struggle while she drew closer. The portrait had not done her credit. She was a creature of life and vitality and was more beautiful in motion than she could be in any frozen image. She was a tall woman, nearly 6 feet, and that was in flat sandals. My throat tightened. I felt tears on my face. "Are you real?" "Why should I not be?" she asked. "You could just be part of Thomas's mental landscape. No offense." She smiled. "No, child, it's really me. In some measure, at least. I prepared you both for this day. I laid this working within reach of each of you. A little portion of who and what I am. I wanted you to know who you were to each other." I drew a shaking breath. "Is he really your son?" My mother smiled, a sparkle in her dark eyes. "You have a perfectly serviceable sense of intuition, little one. What does it tell you?" My vision blurred with tears. "That he is." She nodded. "You must listen to me. I cannot be there to protect you, Harry. The two of you must take care of each other. Your brother will need your help, just as you will need his." "I don't understand this," I said, gesturing at the mirror. "What do you mean he's tired?" My mother nodded at Thomas. "The girl he loved. She's gone. She was his strength. It knows that." "It?" I asked. She nodded at the mirror. "The hunger, his demon." I followed her nod with my gaze. The image, Thomas snarled something under his breath. The hunger in the mirror answered in a slow, slithering tongue I did not understand. "Why didn't you help him?" "I did what I could," my mother said. Her eyes flickered with something dark, an ancient spark of hatred. "I made sure that his father would endure a fitting punishment for what he did to us. You and Thomas? And you, Harry. Raith yet lives, but he is weakened. Together, you and your brother may have a chance against him. You will understand." The hunger hissed more words at Thomas. "What is it saying?" I asked. "It's telling him to give up. That there's no point in fighting anymore, that it will never leave him in peace." "Is it true?" "Perhaps," she said. "But he's fighting anyway," I said. "Yes." Her eyes focused on mine, sad and proud. "It may destroy him, but he will not surrender himself to it. He is of my blood." She drifted to the very edge of the mirror and reached out a hand. It emerged from the mirror's surface as if from a motionless pool. I stepped closer myself, reaching out to touch her hand. Her fingers were soft and warm. She wrapped them around mine and squeezed. Then she lifted her hand and touched my cheek. "As are you, Harry. So tall, like your father. And I think you have his heart as well." I couldn't answer her. I just stood there, silently crying. "I have something for you," she said, "if you are willing." I opened my eyes. My mother stood before me holding what I thought was a small gem or a jewel between long fingers. It pulsed with a low, gentle light. "What is it?" I asked her. "Insight," she said. "It's knowledge?" I asked. "And the power that goes with it," she said. She gave me a half smile touched with irony. It looked familiar. "Think of it as a mother's advice, if you like. It doesn't make up much for my absence, child, but it's all that I have to give." "I accept it," I whispered, because it was the only thing I could give her in return. She passed me the gem. There was a flash, a tingling pain in my head, and then a lingering dull ache. For some reason, that didn't surprise me. You don't gain knowledge without a little pain. She touched my face again and said, "I was so arrogant. I laid too great a burden upon you to bear alone. I hope that one day you will forgive me my mistake. But know that I am proud of what you have become. I love you, child." "I love you," I whispered. "Give my love to Thomas," she said. She touched my face again, her smile loving and sad. Tears slid from her eyes as well. "Be well, my son." Then she drew her arm back into the mirror, and the soul gaze was over. I sat on the floor facing Thomas. There were tears on his face. Both of us looked at each other and then up at my mother's portrait. After a moment, I offered Thomas his pentacle on its chain. He took it and put it on. "Did you see her?" he asked. His voice was shaking. "Yeah," I said. The aching, lonely old hurt was overflowing me, but I suddenly found myself laughing. I had seen my mother with my sight. I had seen her smile, heard her voice, and it was something I could never lose, something no one could ever take away from me. It couldn't wholly make up for a lifetime of loneliness and silent grief, but it was more than I ever thought I would have. Thomas met my eyes, and then he started laughing too. The puppy wriggled his way from my duster's pocket and started bounding back and forth and in circles in sheer joyous excitement. The little nut had no clue at all what we were happy about, but evidently he didn't feel he needed one to join in. I scooped up the puppy and rose. "I had never really seen her face," I said. "I'd never heard her voice." "Maybe she knew you wouldn't have," Thomas replied. "Maybe she did it like that so you could. She told me to tell you that she loved you." He smiled, though it was sad and bitter. "She told me the same thing." "Well," I said, "this changes things some." "Does it?" he asked. He looked uncertain as he said it, frail. "Yeah," I said. "I'm not saying that we're going to start from a fresh slate, but things are different now." "They aren't for me, Harry," Thomas said. He grimaced. "I mean, I knew this already. It's why I tried to help you wherever I could." "I guess you did," I said quietly. "I thought you were just saving up for a favor, but you weren't. Thank you." He shrugged. "What are you going to do about Arturo?" I frowned. "Protect him and his people, of course, if I can. What did Lara mean when she said that Arturo's independence streak was a matter for the White Court?" "Damned if I know," Thomas sighed. "I thought he was just someone Lara knew from the industry." "Does your dad have any connection to him?" "Dad doesn't advertise what he's doing, Harry, and I haven't spoken more than 20 words to him in the last 10 years. I don't know." "With Lara?" "Probably. But ever since Lara worked out that I wasn't just a dim-witted ambulatory penis, she's been on her guard when we've talked. I haven't been able to get much out of her, so now I mostly sit there and nod and look wise and make vague remarks. She assumes that I know something she doesn't, and then she thinks the vague remark is actually a cryptic remark. She wouldn't want to move on me until she's figured out what it is I'm hiding from her." "That's a good tactic if people are paranoid enough. In the Raith household, paranoia comes bottled on tap and in hot and cold running neuroses. What about your dad? He know any magic?" "Like maybe entropy curses?" Thomas shrugged. "I hear stories about things he's done in the past. Some of them must be close to true. Plus, he's got a huge library he keeps locked up most of the time. But even without magic, he can just rip the life out of anyone who pisses him off." "How?" "It's like when we feed. It's usually a slow, gradual thing. But he doesn't need that kind of time or intimacy. Just a touch, a kiss, and wham, they're dead. That whole kiss of death thing in The Godfather? He was where that phrase originated, only for him it was literal." "Really?" "Supposedly. I've never seen him do it myself, but Lara has plenty of times. Madeline once told me that she liked to open conversations that way because it made sure he had the complete attention of everyone still breathing." "Stories, supposedly. For someone on the inside, your information isn't real helpful." "I know," he said. "I'm not thinking clearly right now. I'm sorry." I shook my head. "Can't throw stones." "What do we do?" he asked. I feel lost. I don't know what to do." "I think I do," I said. "What?" Instead of answering him, I offered him my hand. He took it, and I drew my brother to his feet.
Wow. Oh. Wow.
That's a lot, right?
That was a whole lot. Wow. So, okay. All right. So this the soul gaze instead of it just being like Harry seeing who the other person is, it was like a message she left waiting for them for just this moment when they would do this.
Correct.
Right? Yes. That's okay. So, okay, I didn't know that was a thing you could do.
I don't think they did either.
That was really pretty emotional for these books. Mm-hmm. I like that moment where Harry is realizing that everything that just happened with him while he was using his sight, so it's always going to be there for him.
Yeah, I like that a lot, too.
What did she give him?
Insight.
What did she mean when she said she left something that, she did something to Raith that weakened him?
Mm.
What did she do? Is it something he's already weak, or it sounded like if she had already did it and already had taken effect. But she's been dead for a really long time. So has he been weak all this time? I mean, that's also because all these, there's stories about what Raith has done, but it doesn't seem like Thomas has seen him do any of this stuff
mm-hmm.
in his lifetime. So maybe he has been weak, and that's why he just depends on his bodyguards now.
Hmm. It's an interesting theory there.
What was the business that she was into?
I know.
And also, I like, too, that this is kind of like Harry's, like, this is why they all looked at me like I was the, like, second coming of Lucifer or whatever, because his mom had been involved in all this apparently really crazy shit.
Yeah.
Oh, and Thomas doesn't know what to do. He feels lost because that was a lot.
Yeah.
I don't know where they're going. Don't ask me, what do I think? I don't know. I don't know.
What did you think of Thomas's soul?
Oh, listen.
It's really upsetting in a way, you know?
It was like a really horrible mirror of Erised.
Oh, yeah. You know,
it was like some sort of perverse that. And the way that they're described, where they're like hanging, like it's got its claws in Thomas, but Thomas also has his nails in it.
Yeah.
And this tug of war kind of thing that's happening.
Mm-hmm.
And then when she says, but he's still fighting. Well, Harry says he's still fighting. And then she says, yes, he's of my blood. Mm-hmm. Come on. Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And you know what? We didn't talk about it, but Harry apologized to Thomas for being so cruel about Justine.
Yeah, I meant to bring that up and I completely forgot because just so eager. I was overeager.
And so it's kind of, it's nice because they had that moment before this.
Right.
Right? So this is like, I like that they kind of came to, I like that Harry apologized before this, because now it feels like this is, like if there had been an apology after this, then it would have been like, well, of course.
Right.
You know, but somehow the fact that he did it before all of this emotional stuff happened makes me be like, they really could have a thing. They could really have a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they probably won't. I don't know. I mean, he is still a vampire. Oh, that's the other thing, too, about... because Thomas wants to get Inari out of this life, right?
Mm-hmm.
Before she goes 100%
right.
into being a vampire. And this is suddenly so complicated. I don't know. And when Raith was like, Raith knows that that's Harry Dresden.
Yeah.
So he knows that that's Thomas's brother.
Yeah.
Listen, what is happening right now?
Can you imagine how, like, anxious he must have been when he found out that they were, like, running in the same circles all of a sudden?
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Raith says that he hasn't talked to his dad more than 20 words in 10 years. So it's not like they're having conversations about it.
No.
You know, So it's possible that Raith doesn't know, Lord Raith doesn't know whether Thomas, Harry knows, when they meet in the driveway. Mm-hmm. He has no way of knowing whether Harry knows yet.
Yeah, no, about Thomas, doesn't.
Right?
Yeah.
So he's definitely all, it's even more reason to kill him. Of course, well, no. Even, I feel like, yeah, he would want to kill Harry for that. Sure, why not? Yeah. Because, I mean, I don't know if he would care that his baby's mom's kid is running around town. But somehow I feel like Raith would be like, yeah, no, I want to kill him in spite of that. Or because of that.
Hmm.
Or in addition to the other reasons I want to kill him. I don't know, but it makes me think that for some reason this just makes him want to kill Harry even more.
Gotcha.
I don't know. And he says that, what is Harry's mom's name? It's on a portrait. I forget her name. But anyway.
I always want to say Monica. It's so not Monica.
It's something Margaret. With an M. Margaret.
Yes.
She escapes from Lord Raith because he was never able to completely enthrall her. Mm-hmm. So she sounds like she never really loved him. Maybe she was, got sucked into the hoodoo that he does. Mm-hmm. But he could have some, I don't know. I don't even know if Raith's feelings about Margaret are important at this stage of the game. But it just seems like an added layer.
Yeah, definitely.
What is with having a portrait, a hall of all the women that you've had children with?
Oh, God. Doesn't that feel like something Trump would do?
Did he paint himself?
Oh, my God. Probably.
This was a lot.
And, we mentioned that he apologized to Thomas before, but we didn't mention that, because you were saying, Harry was uncharacteristically cruel, and he admits before he apologizes that he was uncharacteristically cruel because he feels guilty because Thomas did to just right. what he feels he did to Susan.
That's right. That's right. He has that moment where he says he's looking, it was like looking in a mirror, mm-hmm. which was weird because later on, Thomas is looking in a mirror, but
yeah,
that's right. Yeah. He sees himself in, which I don't know if that's a fair assessment actually on Harry's part.
I mean, he says even that, it's worse for Thomas because he couldn't help it, and
right.
she's gone, whereas at least Susan's out there living her mm-hmm. life, and, right. she's a vampire now, but she's still alive.
Mm-hmm.
So he admits that it's not equal, right. and that the fact that it's not equal and so much worse for Thomas, probably, he needs to helps get the fuck him. Over himself a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. Like, Harry, I guess, was a danger to Susan, mm-hmm. Susan was in danger because of Harry, but you know what though? Susan made a choice to be there that night, mm-hmm. And Justine made a choice too.
Yep.
So I can't say enough how glad I am that that moment happened before they did the soul gaze.
Yeah. Agreed. Cause it makes it feel like he just knows he had a moment of self-reflection, mm-hmm. realized his own baggage, and,
yep.
Just fessed up to, that wasn't cool, yep. I'm sorry.
Yep.
And it was
yep.
all
yep.
because he felt like that was the right thing to do and not because of this eagerness for family.
Yes, yes. Yeah. How heartbreaking is this talk that he's, when he's remembering what it's like, how lonely he was as a kid and how all he ever wanted was a family, and that moment where he wonders if Thomas felt the same way.
Mm-hmm.
Good Lord.
Yeah.
I didn't know Butcher had it in him.
That's like, it's such a slow burn with these books, but he gets into some real shit. Every now and then he just pulls it out and you're like, okay, I guess that's what we're doing now. Thanks for fucking yeah. no warning at all.
Yeah, exactly, right? Like, 1 minute we're making, weird sex jokes about being on a porn set, and then the next minute...
Yep.
Yo, what about this thing about the fucking dad with the daughters?
Oh!
And how all the sons die mysteriously?
Yeah.
This is that creepiness about my daughter, mine, and dearest daughter and all that. Yeah, no bueno.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. That's no good.
And that's like a really, because I like that it's not just Thomas being like, she doesn't, like, I want to keep my little sister from being a vampire. It's not just that. It's also, my dad, he rapes my sisters.
Yeah.
So it would be cool if he didn't rape this one.
Yeah, yeah. If I could, you know, get her out before that becomes a thing. Mm-hmm. And, now this idea that they can get out of being a vampire if it is love.
Mm-hmm.
For the first time is an interesting idea.
Mm-hmm.
That I don't know if I've ever come across this. You know, there's lots of, well, there's really not lots of talk about different ways to be a vampire. Again, all my vampire knowledge is firmly rooted in the Buffyverse. but this idea that what they are, the White Court anyway, doesn't manifest until they get to a certain age, and if you don't go through the ritual of it, then, well, because like Susan is a vampire, but she's not a whole vampire yet, right this seems to be, and this might not be a fair, maybe I'm misreading it, but this seems to be like, if Inari doesn't, you know, fuck and then kill the first person, that she never becomes a vampire at all.
Right.
And so is it fair to say she's human now and she hasn't, air quote, turned yet?
I
don't know if she's human. Like, I don't know what the state that they're in before they do the big sex kill thing.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know if human, doesn't like, feel maybe right like to say you that could call human.
Them possessed.
Okay.
Because the I'm demon curious. Is in there and, like, it's basically don't satisfy the demon and it won't be able to take over, kind of.
Right. I wonder if she will have any, like, Susan has, like, speed and strength and shit now, you know?
Right.
I wonder if there's any of that for the White Court, or if none of that happens until they feed the hunger the first time. This is so interesting, this almost this different biology, almost. Mm-hmm. Of the various vampires.
Hmm. Yeah, the thing with his sister is really something that I've always been kind of fascinated by. And, you know, I don't know, there's just, like, it's just like you said, it's so creepy. The whole thing with him killing his sons and ensnaring and raping his daughters to keep power over them, and the building of this like family of, it's like it's kind of a way, like I want to compare him to Tywin Lannister, but for Lannisters, you know, they're gonna die, so it's really, you can say it's for the family. This guy probably not gonna die in any like at any point soon, so it's really just about him. You can't even, you know, really say it's like the Raith family. It's yeah, all him.
It's not about legacy for him.
Yeah,
and it like part of me thinks that because when Harry's like, "Aren't you afraid your dad's just gonna do the same thing to you?" and he says, "His tastes don't run that way," so it's almost like. He kills the sons because he can't control them the way he can control the girls.
Right.
And he's, I guess, afraid of being usurped by a son.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to get them out of the way.
Yeah.
But it's curious to me because I'm also used to the idea of vampires, especially in popular culture, being very like, what is it like? I don't know what the right word is, but I don't want to say bisexual because I don't think it's about sexuality, but being like feeding fluid. On men being very fluid, you know, they will feed on men and feed on women and, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And the fact that the dad doesn't is,
kind of surprising.
It's surprising, and it's also, Well, it's weird because with the White Court, their whole vampire thing is very tied to sex, though. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So maybe they don't. Maybe... Oh, that's another fucking weird rabbit hole.
This like is that's actually something that I got a little hung up on, and I'm still a little bit like, oh, okay, so he just can't possibly, and that's just gives Thomas a complete out. And, like, okay, but it does, it did distract me.
Yeah. I think that's a good, yeah, and I'm not, like, I don't even know if I want, I'm not going to go as far as calling it a plot hole or anything. But it just, I think the fact that he only does it to the daughters makes it infinitely more gross and creepy. Mm-hmm. And takes it out of the whole just vampires need to feed and makes it a whole other thing.
Yeah.
It may be for, like, as a writer, that's the effect you want to have. So that's why you have it that way. Mm-hmm. Because you want it to be particularly disturbing.
Yeah.
Which, well done.
It did. Correct.
Jesus Christ. Jesus. Wow, that was a lot. That was really, like, towards the end there. That was pretty, it was like right in the fields.
Yeah, I think this was a much better choice for the live read than the first one would have been.
Yeah, agreed.
Where it's just a lot of talk about love and then suddenly our mom.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, that would have been no way to end.
No, you'd have been like, I'm sorry, excuse me. Yeah. And I'm like, all right, thanks everybody for listening. Yeah, so this just opens up a lot of room for other things to happen, for new characters to come in and suddenly be, like, important.
Mm-hmm.
For plot threads that we didn't even know were there.
Yeah, because like Harry sums it up, like he's got to fucking defeat the Dark Lord. We got to save Inari. We got to protect Arturo. We got to figure out who's behind the entropy curse, You know. And now we've got Thomas' half brother, and whatever this gem of insight was, you know. The plot definitely just thickened.
Dun dun dun. yeah, and this is. Because I started off this book when I was telling you how I felt about it. I was like, you know, the main plot of this, whatever. It's all the subplots that I'm, like, really excited about. And now you're getting what I'm saying with that. Like,
I'm starting to see.
These things are not technically, like, the main thrust of the story because it's the investigation of this thing. But, like, you know. Who cares? They're brothers.
Yeah,
what?
Really.
one could argue that that is the subplot and this is the plot. But
I would allow it.
Plot. It's a very charming way of saying that, Natasha. You are so eloquent. Thank you, Natasha. So yeah, is there anything else you wanted to mention on this? I feel like I have this feeling like we're missing something that I intended to like talk about, but there is so much here.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody corrected me, by the way, last episode. I think you said that the brother and sister that wore the tennis whites all the time were white. You were like, weren't they white court? And I was like, no, they were black court. They weren't. They were red court. And I meant red court, but I always say black court because I think of the fact that they turn into those black bat-like monsters when they take their skin off.
Oh, right.
So I call them, like, black.
Oh, that's right. They worked with Bianca.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right. I forgot about that.
Well, I want to, first of all, say thank you, everybody, because I checked iTunes today. Somebody asked me for a link to the show, and I went and checked iTunes for Unspoiled, and, it turns out Dresden Files is number 2 when you search Dresden Files in iTunes.
Yay.
The show. So that's kind of rad. Who knew? It like, and it's not necessarily that we're like a better show. There are so few Dresden Files shows. I think I saw like 3 other ones. Whereas, you know, the Harry Potter show is 1 out of like 60. So I think that's part of it is that because the other show that came up when I searched it that was above us, I guess it really only came up above us because ours is Unspoiled : Dresden Files and theirs is just called The Dresden Files Show because their show only has 9 reviews. So we've got 50-something. So, like, really, we're ahead. But we didn't come out first, which I'm sort of side-eyeing iTunes for. But that's fine. Whatever. I'm not mad at it. It's cool. But, yeah. So I just, like, thank you, everybody, so much for, you know, leaving reviews, because that's what does it. We don't get to the top of lists unless we are big on the reviews. That's like how, and it may sound like I'm contradicting my previous point, since they only had 9 reviews and they came up high. But like I said, if there aren't that many reviews that, or not that many shows that exactly match up with what you search, then you have a lot better luck. So it's like way, way more important on certain things that we cover, because there are so many other competing shows. But it's really nice to see us so close to the top. And it's nice, like, to realize that I'm filling a void, that there weren't many people talking about the show, and definitely not in this kind of, like, unspoiled first-time reader sort of way. It's all been very involved readers who have done the whole series and are coming at it completely spoiled.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So I shared a link to somebody who was asking about it in a group about the Dresden Files. And a lot of people seemed really interested and were like, hey, thanks for stealing years of my life away. To which I'm like, I am not stealing years from your life. I'm adding life to your years. Lol. I am an annoying Pinterest quote. So I'm going to say hi to new patrons. Hello. Okay, moving on. I'm just kidding. this week we have Kate of the North, Farah Jaffrey, Michael Donaghy, Emily Merrill, Brett LaForge, Silji Aaron Strom, Charles Dunlap, Sarah Giles, Lucia Bennett, Denise Booth, Alex Irwin. What's up, Alex? Shelby Barbie and Chess Andrews all became patrons. Welcome, all of you guys. Make sure to join the patrons-only Facebook group, which many of you have done already, and the patrons-only Discord chat. And, you know, what's up? Thanks. You're awesome. And a couple of you were at $20 and above, which means you will get access to the very exclusive show that RoShawn and I are doing called Unsober, where we talk about a random subject. And this last one that we just posted is about weddings. And I believe it was Alex who said that he felt very called out. Because we talked about how white people throw parties versus how, for example, in my family, Colombian people throw parties. And he was like, everything you said about white people parties is how I throw parties. I was like, hey, there's nothing wrong with that. It's just a little bit of an adjustment.
At my age, those are the parties I'm into. Honestly. I'm all about the white people parties now.
Yeah.
Let me have a seat, please, on the couch. Have better quality liquor.
Yeah, that too.
The music isn't as loud.
Oh my God. The Colombian parties, they all drank that aguardiente. Have you ever had that shit?
Mm-mm.
It smells like black licorice. It's nasty. It's like,
oh,
goodness.
That's like anisette.
Yeah. But it's like bitterer, because anisette has a little bit of a sweetness to it, and this doesn't.
Or Sambuca?
Maybe. I haven't had Sambuca. It might be more like that. And the reek of it, because they would drink and then they would like dance and play games and they'd be sweating. So the air just smelled like it. It was rough. Anyway, side tangent there. But yeah, so if you are $20 and up, you will get that. If you are $10 and up, you are going to be getting an awesome postcard in the mail very shortly. They finally arrived from my order. It took a while. Moo. I'm looking at you. And if you are $5 and up, we are going to be coming out with a new patrons-only show soon. I posted a poll up in the patrons-only group to ask what you would like. And right now, I believe Black Mirror is at the top. It got upvoted the most. So stay tuned, because I have to figure out exactly how to fit that into the schedule. But I've been wanting to watch Black Mirror. I'm just a little worried about it because it's such a fucking bummer.
Wait, you haven't seen Black Mirror?
I haven't seen past seasons 1 and 2. I covered the first 2 seasons with Miles.
Oh, right.
And I'd kind of like to continue covering it with him.
Yes, you should.
But
you should continue watching it.
But I have, like, he has a pretty packed schedule because my podcast is not the only podcast he does. He does a storytelling podcast. He does a Smash Fiction podcast. So I may have to find another host. And so we'll see. But I just want to let you all $5 and up know that I'm thinking about you and I'm planning things. And don't worry, you won't be adrift for too long. And I think there was something else I wanted to add, but I can't remember. So that's going to have to be it. Is there anything you want to add?
No, ma'am.
All right. Oh, you know what? I know what it was. If you go to unspoiledpodcast.com/merch, I started a merch store on TeePublic that is divided into albums. And there is a Dresden Files album that has some things that I made, but also I am able to curate designs from all over that site into that album. And there are some really fun Dresden Files related t-shirts and notebooks and mugs and whatever. I am making sure not to curate anything into that that has a spoiler. So all of that is safe for anybody. But if you just search Dresden Files when you go to TeePublic, you will get your ass spoiled. So be careful. Just be careful is all I'm saying. But yeah, unspoiledpodcast.com/merch. Support us and go to unspoiledpodcast.com/Amazon to shop, because that's a good thing that all of us always do anyway, that you can do and help support us without even having to think about it. If you just bookmark it, boom, done. Always. It's honestly adding up. Like, I can tell that there are some people that have bookmarked it and always use it, because it's been a pretty consistent amount of money that I get from it every month, for the first time in a while. So thank you to everybody who's decided to do that, because it really does help me, and it can save my ass every now and then. So, you know, cool. All right. I really swear I'm done this time. I hope you all enjoyed the live read. For those of you who haven't experienced one of those, because I did a bunch of them for Harry Potter. And if there is a particular chapter that you really think should get a live read, you know, message me. Facebook.com/unspoiledpod or Twitter at unspoiledshow. And you can email me at unspoiledpodcast@gmail.com. All right. You ready, ma'am?
I'm ready.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much for listening. And we will see you next week with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.